Namaste. Welcome to another session of Chatinar. Today we are talking about agriculture in digital India.
We have got along with me three panelists, Sriram, Vamsi and Anant. It's a very diverse background. All four of us come from. We have got corporate representation. We have got your startup representation and someone who was a startup and is back to corporate. So it's going to be a pretty interesting discussion. In brief, if I was to kind of put Indian agriculture in and the technology perspective, if you look at the Indian agriculture, like from pre-harvest to post-harvest and to the customer point, few points which come to mind reading from news articles and other information available, that there's a huge price volatility in both the input side and the output side. A lot of inefficiencies in the supply chain, financial transactions. And these are the areas farm mechanization and farm management needs a significant improvement. So these are areas which we probably will try to cover in the next 1 hour. With that, I'll let Sriram give a brief introduction, followed by Vamsi and Anant.
Hi, everyone. I was a banker for about 16 years with various foreign banks. Focus was largely on large project finance. So I did farming for 3 years in Maharashtra. One of the big learnings from this experience as a farmer was that the big challenge in agriculture, especially in the fruits and vegetable sector, lay in terms of what happened between the farm gate and the consumer. And that's the reason why I decided to switch and focus more on building the supply chain rather than doing farming. So I built a farm to consumer business. Currently, I am a part of the agri strategy team at Reliance.
Hi, everyone. I'm Vamsi Udegiri, founder of HESA. If there is one thing that fascinates me or gives me passion is Indian rural ecosystem and the potential it has. And I'm a firm believer of any impact has to be at a scale. We at HESA bridge the last mile commerce for rural by bringing in three important elements, which is social, physical and digital together. So we are a kind of a marketplace offering many services that a rural consumer would need. In this case, a farmer can use HESA platform for their entire agri value chain, right from doing a soil testing, for buying agri inputs, taking loans, insurance, and most important, forward linkages, which is selling the agri produce.
My name is Anant. I work with Coromandel International Limited, part of Murugappa Group. We are an agri input organization. We manufacture fertilizers. We are a leader in phosphatic fertilizer. We also manufacture insecticides, pesticides, herbicides. We have our own retail chain of 800 stores with a brand called Managromor Centers, where we sell our own manufactured products as well as our Compete products to the farmers direct.
I'm Ramesh Rao, worked nearly 25 years in the corporate side, manufacturing product launches, some amount of service industry, and then jumped into the entrepreneurial race. We are a startup which is building advanced automation solutions for mostly the post-harvest side of the produce. Our first key focus is on the red chilies. So that's where we are creating advanced automation. Let's jump in. I have the first question in. How critical is automation for future success of an organization? I'm assuming you're looking at it in two manner. One is, how is automation going to help in the production side of either fertilizers or farm mechanization machinery or anything like that? And second, I'm assuming, is how would automation be actually useful in the field itself, where how these machines will work in. So I'll let Anant start with how Coromandel is using technology and automation to improve their production processes and productivity. And I'll take it up from there on how our solutions are going to help the industry going forward.
Can you imagine a world without computer? So in this COVID times, these platforms are not there. We would have not been chatting like this efficiently and doing the work efficiently. So it is as important as these small applications for us inside the manufacturing processes as well. If you see the technology landscape in any process industry, and over the past 10, 15 years, there have been radical changes inside the production process and automation levels. Now, if you see that 60 to 70% of the manual processes which are there in a typical manufacturing process got converted, mechanized or automated in some way or the other. Even in the fertilizer industry, 70% of the work is done by the robots inside the organization, and process is almost like we are going towards a human-less manufacturing company. But slowly, we can see that happen in next 5 or 6 years. Apart from that, like if you take the procurement of the raw materials to the conversion of the part to a finished goods, to supplying that material to the end customers and reach to the farmers. In every process, there is a technology aspect involved and automation involved. Government of India runs an ERP solution for the fertilizer companies on its own. So if people know about the fertilizer sector or industry, the manufacturers get the fertilizer subsidy for every bag what we sell in the market. So after Modi coming in and like after we having an Aadhaar system, there is fertilizer management system which the Government of India tracks to the last bag which is consumed by the farmer. And we get a subsidy on each bag only when a farmer consumes a bag. And now the government is tracking to that level, to what level a farmer is utilizing what type of fertilizer and to what quantities for the amount of acreage what he is sowing. So there is a great involvement of automation or technology in each aspect of the manufacturing sector as well.
Automation is also very critical in the actual field where the agriculturists and the farming community is using them. Automation is always going to help in productivity and reduce costs. Farming community is going to earn or make more money if they adapt to any kind of automation. So it's very critical that automation is taken up. Also, because of labor issues, labor shortage issues, automation is going to help in every manner. So to answer your question, yes, automation is very critical. And India is trying to adopt automation in the farming community and with a lot of success.
I have a point to add here.
Vamsi, go ahead.
Based on our experience with HESA, we are working with biotech organizations who are doing a lot of research on plant animal life sciences and genomics especially. And also a few more organizations who are using geospatial weather data in terms of helping the productivity of the farm. There are a lot of tech players who have come into this segment in terms of IoT, sensors, robotics, and they're all technologies who are really helping farmers at a farm level to definitely increase their production capacity.
There are a few more comments and questions on this. We will kind of loop back because I would also like to go to the next side of the discussion, which is post-harvest, farm to customer, where Sriram has done some significant work in his startup days. So Sriram, over to you on how technology and especially in supply chain, storage, logistics can be utilized to benefit the farmer with enabling their produce to reach to the customer with the best benefit.
When we talk about agriculture in India, I think one of the things that we need to understand is that there are two distinct verticals within agriculture, both completely different from each other. One is relating to the food grains, and the other is largely the fruits and vegetables. The reason it is important to make this distinction is that food grains, which includes cereals like rice, wheat, as well as the pulses and oilseeds, these are largely non-perishables, and therefore the supply chain for this from the farmer to the consumer is quite different from fruits and vegetables, which are perishable. So channels which are required in both these cases are completely different. And in fact, in almost every aspect, these two need to be addressed differently when we're looking at farming in India. So in terms of the supply chain for food grains first, what most of us know that the farm sizes in India are quite small. The average farm size is something like about 1 hectare, which is about 2.5 acres. So what each farmer is producing is only to that extent. So if I look at wheat, on 2.5 acres, you can produce maybe about 2.5 to 3 tons. If you're very efficient, maybe 2 to 3.5. But that is not a very large quantity for the traders and the corporates to kind of get in and buy. So then what typically happens is that all of this produce gets aggregated at the local market, at the local mandi, by either the traders, aggregators, and then it is further procured by the larger corporates and people who do the packaging. Now, here in terms of the areas where technology can play a big role, because these are all small farms, there is no standardization. Each farmer, what he produces is completely different from the other one. So where technology can come in is to standardize, take into the market. At the market, now there are a number of startups who are already doing things like that. Like, for example, startups which have optical identification of food grains, for example, rice or wheat. You look at using a mobile phone, you can track the quality, the size, what is the broken element, etc., and then categorize. And once technology enables this categorization, it's much easier to trade and therefore take it to the next level. And even at the warehouse level, there's a whole lot of technology interventions which are possible in terms of track. In India, unfortunately, we don't have the silo system which, for example, the US uses. Everyone packages individual crop food grains in bags and gets stored. How do you track those? What quality is stored where? How do you control that this is not getting spoiled because of moisture, etc.? There's a lot of technological interventions possible in that. And subsequently in supply chain, when it moves from the warehouse to the ultimate processor and to the consumer, there is enough and more technology interventions in the logistics chain in terms of tracking and managing the moisture content, the packaging process, all of that which is possible. Now, the other part is the supply chain for fruits and vegetables, which are quite complicated actually. The reason is you cannot store it, except for maybe onions and potatoes. For most other produce, once harvested, it needs to reach the consumer very, very quickly. Therefore, it means that the produce needs to get to the market. It is graded. And today, most of the gradation is happening visually. We do not have technology because in fruits and vegetables, there's a lot of variation based on the growing condition. What is the chemical content in the soil? What is the weather? What has been sprayed, fertilizer, etc. Then based on the visual grading, it is moved to the next stage. And from there, it is transported to the ultimate market. In all of this, the more the fruit and vegetables get handled, the greater the chance of spoilage. What now startups and companies are trying to do is technological intervention in the gradation process in the initial stage. Then there is intervention in terms of cold stores. How do you use cold chain to move it from the consumer? Let's say, for example, how do you get apples from Himachal in Bangalore? Then finally, at last mile, there's also the challenge of how you distribute it from the markets to the end consumer. There again, there's a lot of companies who are starting to use, whether it is Big Basket or Ninja Cart, they are starting to use a lot of technology in kind of getting the products distributed rapidly before there is any shortage.
Thanks. A follow-up on the first question on automation. Automation comes at a cost. Considering the fact that farmer is at the beginning of the value chain, are corporates ready to pay for the automation as it benefits the corporate as well? So Malesh, you have already answered it. Yes, corporates have to do that. It's a very simple, keeping the farmer first is the most important thing, because farmer in this whole value chain is the biggest customer. We may think that, you know, the customer is the consumer and all, but for every startup and corporate and any enterprise who is supporting agriculture community, farmer is the biggest customer, and it is very important that corporates and enterprises take care of that and keep the farmer as well.
I'm saying that like I'm glad that somebody asked that question. So Malesh, I totally agree with you, and I'll share some of our learnings at Coromandel on that specific aspect of corporate speaking of that automation cost. We have learned it the hard way in terms of experimenting with automation on the ground with the farmers. You've seen about e-commerce for the farmers to go and he's getting the buyers and sellers together for the farm produce there. So we have tried all that earlier and found that no one has come to you. No one is going to pick up those things quickly, especially in the farming sector. So we have created multiple platforms like that. And today, after testing a lot of waters, we say that we've created an aided e-commerce kind of model for the farmers, where we have deployed on the field staff of our own people who get the farmer to the technology platform and make them operate and aid them. That is the situation where we are. So corporates, it's not just about Coromandel, our competes, other agri input kind of organizations. Every one of them is going on a spree where they are picking up the automation cost, and they are giving these as a value added services to the farmers. Of course, we are not a charity organization. We do business, and we understand that there are customers. So we are giving these things as a value-added services to the farmers, so that we can bring them to buy all other products of ours and improve our business also.
I just want to pick up one question. How we can make it sustainable for farmers to stay in the villages when profit margins are shrinking every year? So Vamsi, I know that you are doing a lot of work at grassroots levels. We would like you to speak about, you know, how you're working with the villagers and the farmers in the villages and helping them make it a sustainable business model.
If you see, especially in the agri value chain, there are a lot of interventions that are needed for a farmer, right from the input side to the value added services, to the processing, to the precision farming, and right access to loans. And then you have accessories like your crop stock and all. So, and most important is forward linkages. If today a farmer is given a right price for his product, I think that is what he is looking at. These are all the subsets of this entire piece. So obviously there are a lot of challenges this farming community faces because of this lot of interventions in this entire value chain. And this is where a lot of organizations are coming to actually, you know, venture into this space, trying to give solutions. But as someone said, I think one way or other, there are like a lot of solutions who are coming and bombarding the farming community. Like partly, if I do an automation solution in my farm, it may help to increase my productivity, but still there is a challenge to sell my produce. If I try to do that, still there is a problem in, you know, access to right loan at right time, post-harvest loans and all. So there is a whole lot of challenges this entire farming community across the value chain faces. And this is where we at HESA thought that a farmer who is in a village, who is trying to actually earn a decent livelihood by actually, you know, doing something which is really next to godliness. So rather than he or she going to 10 different places, why can't we provide an aggregated platform which is a combination of physical and digital? Because today, how much ever we talk about digital agriculture at all, today, you know, less than 7-8% of the farming community are only accessing this entire digital technology. So it's all about creating an intermittent layer by creating that physical layer, you know, in terms of people who can enable farming communities. So this is where, you know, we have aggregated the entire value chain for a farmer, as I said, right from the agri input stage to the value added services to the forward linkages, where at every touch point, how we can help farmer by bringing in those expertise solutions, like somebody may be good at genomics, somebody may be good at agri input, someone may be in loan processing, or someone to, you know, and entirely manage the forward linkages. So this is where we thought, I think, the assisted commerce or the assisted farming, you know, model, where if we can help the farming community across their agri value chain, I think that's where farmer, rather than going to 10 different places, being exploited, doesn't know what to do, I think he can get a better price or better value for his entire system is our thesis and the model we are working in.
Thanks, Vamsi. I want to take a question. So his question is there an opportunity for indoor farming based on LED lighting in controlled environments in India, or CapEx is a big deterrent? CapEx is always a issue, especially in the farming community in India, because of not a large amount of availability of cash at any given point of time. Yes, it is possible. You have to be very adaptive with your business model and your revenue model. If you are trying to sell the whole container with the indoor lighting systems and all the peripherals attached, an Indian farmer on his own probably may find it very expensive, but there would be corporates who can help you establish the product in India. You know, you could have like a revenue model which is not just a B2B sale or a direct sale to someone, but some kind of a service model should help, you know, kind of create a win-win situation. This is what we are kind of doing for the product we are developing. It is a high capex product. What we are doing is a pay-by-use kind of a revenue model, where the farming community can come with their produce, use the equipment, and pay by the amount of usage. If I was to draw a corollary there, you could actually do something similar. Take the advantage of the farming community to process the produce in the indoor environment and help sell them using any kind of platforms.
Ramesh, if I could add to this, the other thing typically what you would kind of do with indoor lighting, etc., is when in countries where you have a problem with natural lighting. It's typically in countries which are further north in the latitude where you don't have sufficient lighting, where you would want to indoor growing with the artificial lighting, etc. But that fortunately is not such a big issue in India. We have globally, I think India has the second largest chunk of agricultural land, and being located close to the tropics, we have a lot of natural sunlight. So the cost of putting up the infrastructure, kind of do artificial lighting, indoor agriculture, probably will get beaten by what is kind of being grown outside. Now, the one case where it might kind of make sense is where you are doing ultra-perishable stuff, which needs to be used in urban centers and therefore needs to be located very close to the urban centers. And this kind of stuff is the exotic things like cherry tomatoes, the salad leaves, etc., which a lot of people are kind of using hydroponics with artificial lighting. And for that, it might make sense, but the key thing is to find the critical mass in terms of buyer consumers. This is because for this, it is largely the hotel industry, which is the consumer for these kind of the exotic produce, which is grown in hydroponics and with artificial lighting. That market, if there is sufficient market there and a consistent one, then I think it might make sense. But otherwise, it is a big challenge in terms of economic justification.
Yeah. But still, the business model would have to be some kind of a service model or something like that.
But in case of a controlled farming environments, especially when you deal with sericulture or some specific crops, I think it is already yielding some good results. But yeah, as Sriram said, keeping in mind the economic conditions to it.
Yeah. So, and Vamsi, continue on that. There's a question, how to make digital technology accessible and usable to a small and poor farmer who are rooted in traditional methods of farming and marketing?
Sure. See, there are making farmers use certain technologies for their own production or those things, which definitely has a cost impact attached to it. But there are a lot of models, a lot of startups that we are working with. Anyone has an innovative solution or a solution which can benefit the farmers, we try to take the product at the last mile. So there are certain players who are actually offering these as a service model, as a value addition model or a result-based models wherein, okay, I mean, I give this service of helping you to do precision farming and based on the result, probably I charge something. Very nascent stage though, but yes, these technologies adoption with a small and poor farmers, there are challenges in doing it. But when it's coming to making farmer use all these services, because I don't need as a farmer to actually have an access to a digital platform. If these all can be enabled, wherein I need a soil testing where if that service is made available in my vicinity or a village, or I'm looking for instant post-harvest clone thing, or I'm looking for inputs on the value-added services or on the forward linkages. So this is where these all services can be offered to the farmers. Today, we are working with a lot of small, marginal and poor farmers in terms of helping them increase their output value or get a right loan at a right time, these things. So I think combination of these two, I think making sure that the farmer uses technologies at a scale today, I personally feel that we as an Indian economy, I think we are still farther away.
Yes, Anand, please go ahead.
Second, what Vamsi has told just now on it, because our experience is very, very similar. She has put it's a challenge. I'll say it's a huge challenge in India. Okay, that's the quantum which I add to it. Because if you see the rural landscape or the kind of people who do farming or the kind of resources they have reached to and all this stuff, it's all 80-20 principle there. 80% of the farmers are like these very, very small farmers who have small parcels of land, and they are getting digital to them is a huge challenge. It's a huge, huge challenge for us, because like we try, it's like a crusade. We make all the efforts to do that, but the kind of response what we're getting today or the kind of adoption rate what we're tracking, ever since I've joined, at least in Coromandel, I've been doing that since last 3 years. And at least for the aided e-commerce models or the value-added services or the farm advisory services, what we are taking to the farmer space, I see that the adoption rate is somewhere between 2-3%. So it's a question for which at least there is no answer from the corporate side saying that how do we do that? We all know that it's a challenge and we all know that adoption is low. But the question is how to do that? There is no one successful model which can be repeated today. It's all hit and trial which is going on. And in some places, it is good. Some places, it is bad. Some places, it is worse. But like we're all trying to putting our efforts in terms of like improving it. You see, there's a lot of scope to improve on that space.
Another question just popped in. Who is the driver taking the technology to the farmer? Is it the corporates across the value chain or the government?
Government has made a full effort there. They've given a good push. But responsibility is corporates. I'll say that. Like, wasn't the responsibility lies with the corporates who are making their money and livelihood on the farmers. So they have that, let's say, social responsibility, but like a huge responsibility on their shoulders to take technology to the farmers. They have the right reach, resources, money, and they have everything where they can reach out to farmer and improve that in that space. It's, for me, it is corporate, it's not the government.
So I will also spin this question to both Shriram and Vamsi. Shriram, you can go first. And how much support were you getting from the government when you were doing the startup?
Let me kind of put it in a slightly different perspective. You know, when you look at agriculture as an industry, in any industry, you will always design the model based on what the consumer wants, not on the what the producer is capable of making. It's very important for all of us to start looking at agriculture also from the same perspective, because the only way you can benefit the producer is when you design the entire system based on what the consumer wants. So in this case, people who are able to assess what the consumer wants and therefore design a supply chain or an entire business model around what will work, what will not work, are the corporates. What the government will do is that they will enable the regulatory environment, they will provide the infrastructure that needs to kind of go to support this, and also kind of provide systemic changes or support which is required. But ultimately, it is going to be the corporates which will have to kind of drive this. The only role where government is currently playing in the entire supply chain is the food grains which go into the public distribution system. For the rest of the stuff which comes from the farmer to us, I think the government is increasingly looking to get out of it, because currently the only role that they play is in the form of either regulating the mandis at the state level and the warehousing which is provided by, let's say, someone like a Food Corporation of India. Increasingly, I think what these farm laws also indicate is that the government wants to move out of these areas and have the private sector play the role of providing this infrastructure, whereas government takes on a regulatory role in this whole thing. And that is how any industry should work. Building the technology in this sector, I think the role clearly is that of the corporates. Having said that, I think one of the points which the question also mentioned is that I think today the corporates will build the technology into the supply chain. And I think there would be some amount of time before it actually gets to the farmer. So the fact that it is not getting to the farmer should not be a cause of concern at the moment. Once we get the supply chain more efficient, the farmer will automatically benefit.
So definitely, I think government has a major role to play, which irrespective of the governments are, you know, doing their bit. Other than that, yes, corporates, because they really drive a lot of things at a grassroots level. But I think there are two more stakeholders. One, the research institutions or the knowledge hubs who are also playing a major role in terms of engaging these communities or coming up with better solutions or to do the knowledge transfer to the farmers. These logistics, warehouse, distribution organizations, like, you know, which Sriram just touched upon, they are also playing a role. And I think the entire ecosystem has to come together. As I would actually divide corporates and startups as a separate segment. If you see the kind of focus that Agri has gotten, especially in the last 5-6 years, after a lot of startups focused on the Agri, considering that there is a huge potential, because still 2-3% is like Indian agriculture community is not even got into digitalization or whatever. So I think startups also has a place, major role to play. And because irrespective of whatever offering, services, technology, it has to reach to the right person at the right place. So there are a lot of players who are working at a grassroots level, and these are all the torchbearers who are actually taking it to the last mile. So I think combination of all these things are trying to help farming communities there.
The government does help a lot. I personally know that. There are a lot of government schemes, especially for startups, both in terms of providing knowledge, providing grants to help you grow, scale up. There are a lot of schemes available by them. So I would suggest that take a look at that.
I think for farmers to actually, you know, invest in this, digital agriculture or precision agriculture, I think if government can come up with incentives in terms of, you know, risk sharing or buyback options or contract farming, some, you know, options, I don't see much of those activities happening. Because, for example, a lot of farmers whom we work with say that, okay, I'm ready to, do this. Or I want to convert into organic, I want to use these technologies, but who will guarantee? I think for a certain cycle or a period, if there are certain schemes where government can come up, a couple of these options, I think that can be a very good value addition, other than initiatives taken by them.
I actually have a very, very interesting question. It says, how do you see voice and vernacular making the adoption easier for farmers?
Yeah, I think, needless to say, I think with India with so many languages and that too at a grassroots level, there's large, use of mother tongue there, vernacular. I see a very large role, this both voice and vernacular play, because that's why we see today a lot of solutions which are vernacular, which are actually, talks to the farmer as if, it's built out for them. There are a lot of interventions coming in, during that front. But yeah, I see a great role this vernacular can play reaching out to the farming community.
I'll say that's not a problem with farmers. It's a problem with me also, because I still think in my vernacular. I was talking to you guys in English. Some question is asked, or my thought process is still in my mother tongue and my mother language. That's not just for the farmers. It's for everyone. So I can relate to it, but it is by default. I'll say that whatever application what we're building right now is by default made into the different languages of the marketplaces where we operate or we intend to operate. So I think past are the days where we are building the applications only in one language or purely for English, because if we are an Indian company, not just Coromandel as a company, if you take any manufacturing company or any company services organization which is spread across different states, I think by default we start communicating or reaching out to them their respective vernacular language, starting from our website to our corporate communication, to the brochures, leaflets, and pamphlets, what we give on the field to the farmers, or the video, the digital marketing campaigns, what we do from start to the end, it is in respective vernaculars only now. I think this is a trend since at least past 4 or 5 years now, what I've seen.
I have two questions now. So first is, how much market is left for automation in India to procure for new startups? First, I'll start and then I'll let others speak. The potential is huge. Automation itself is at a very nascent stage of, if you were to look at end-to-end supply chain of agriculture, the opportunities are huge. There is a lot of scope, especially for young students like you, to develop technologies which are suited for the Indian farming community. You need to understand the big difference between large developed country which has got huge farm sizes. The kind of technology and automation needed there is very different from what is needed for an Indian farmer, where the landholding sizes are not very large. You need to kind of build solutions which are actually suitable for the Indian market, and the market potential is huge. I would say that we have not even touched the tip of the iceberg here. What we are doing is we are creating a solution which uses advanced technologies like image processing and IoT and AI to separate a chili pod and the stem. So it's a pretty simple thing which is currently done manually. If I was to give you the market size, India produces 2.4 million tons of, it's just such a small machine going to create in terms of the amount of market which is available. And you can do amazing amount of work in automation, like robotic to de-weeding systems. And there are a lot of startups actually working in that area. I personally think the scope is huge. One more question just popped up. What to produce and how much to produce data points for farmers to create more efficient ecosystem for agriculture industry? Is this possible to create such an ecosystem? And is based in your experience across India?
So here, I think basically, if you see the basic intellect is already there with the farmer. Whatever we, said and done, we come up with a lot of solutions. I think the person who is sitting in a village is much smarter and he understands what he is doing in. So yes, I think in terms of what to produce and how much to produce depending on the acreage or the land that he has. But what to produce, yes, there are a lot of these advisory solutions. This is where a lot of startups have started working, a lot of corporates. I'm sure Coromandel does a lot of work on farm advisory to the farmers in terms of guiding them based on seasons, various crop cycles and the current market conditions. Probably he may be at a better stage to answer it, but definitely, I think the basic intellect is there, which just need to be polished, is what I feel.
So here on this, I think I have a slightly different take on this. People don't realize how important this is as a question, because today, both in food grains as well as in fruits and vegetables, we have a lot of overproduction in a lot of commodities. That is the reason why you have these kind of cases where you hear of farmers getting 2 rupees per kg of a tomato, onion or potato, or not getting enough money for growing rice and wheat. This knowledge getting transmitted to the farmers is a very, very important thing. Because the farmer is a very, very small person in this whole thing and does not have a macro level data about what is the total demand in the system and what is currently going to be supplied based on what is being grown. That responsibility should rest with the government in terms of tracking what is currently being grown and therefore providing some kind of an advisory at a district level or a taluka level in terms of what can be grown. Earlier, this would have been very, very difficult because by the time the information gets collected at a district level in terms of what is being grown and collected at a central level, it's already outdated. But now with satellite technology, using which you can literally look at what is being grown in a farm, just by looking at the satellite image of the crops which are there, government can actually kind of provide advisories in terms of what should be grown. You can tell a farmer that, look, farmers in other districts have already planted so much of tomato, so it may not be a good idea to plant more tomato. And I think that is something which is very, very important and needs to be done at a fairly urgent level to prevent these situations where farmers end up getting a huge loss in these.
It's also a pretty good startup idea, I would say. And you know,
there are a couple already doing it. There's a company called Cropin which is doing it.
Yeah.
But the point is that to aggregate this data at a national level and to kind of feed it back into the system, that role needs to go to the government. The private sector can provide the technological solution, but ultimately it will have to be handled by.
One question which was asked, precision agriculture, it is very matured in few countries, countries with people, processes and technologies. Where is India? It looks like we are struggling. I agree. There are countries which are very developed when it comes to precision engineering. So two ways of looking at it. Are we struggling? I see it as a great opportunity. We don't have to go through the same development cycle which these advanced countries went through to reach the point of precision. We will pick it up from where they are today. And if we adopt it and grow from here, then we are at par. Actually, use it to our benefit and advantage. Pick the technology as it stands in developed countries today and grow it from there to suit to the Indian market. Are we struggling? The answer is no. For me, it's a great opportunity to take the technology and adapt it to the Indian farming community. Anand?
Yeah. I'll say that we corporates basically are in a phase where we are doing lots and lots of experiments in trying to create commercially feasible models on precision agriculture. There have been a lot of movements going on saying that there is rampant usage of pesticides everywhere. Today we are eating vegetables or fruits or all the crops where the usage of pesticides is more and we're fighting for that, right? But why is that? Because if you see the farmer, now there is a pest infestation in one corner of the plot or the crop. Basically, he uses these pesticides across the entire region as a caution or a precaution just to ensure that okay, this is not spreading elsewhere. If we use the principles of precision agriculture, basically, you can exactly plot the area with the kind of satellite imagery or the drone-based imageries. You can exactly plot the area where the infestation, which part of the crop, which type of the crop is infested with this pest, and where is it spreading and in which direction. So that you go with using the same drone, you can apply a controlled amount of pesticide only to that area so that it is controlled there in that part. But it's all exciting to listen and hear, right? But to create a commercially feasible model of applying that technology on the field on a large scale, which can be made available to general farming community, we are a bit far away. I'll use a far away, but it may be negative, but like, yes, we are not still not there. As I told in my opening statement, we are making experiments. We are deliberating on lots and lots of use cases where we can create commercially feasible models of creating precision agriculture things inside our farming company.
Thanks, Anand. And thanks to us for rejoining. Last statements from you and then we...
I just want to add a point here before Suhas closes. One point across this is also the lack of access of financial solutions to the farmers. That also can really help to scale.
Thanks, Vamsi. Thanks, speakers. In my personal perspective, it was quite an interactive. I don't know how much of a pre-planned thing Ramesh had, but if he did have, most of it got derailed completely because of the furious stream of questions.
Which I love you, yeah.
Interaction which came in from our attendees. So I thank you all. I thank you, speakers Sriram, Anand, Vamsi, Ramesh for hosting it. And at the end, I would like to thank our sponsors as well. Axon Technologies, MVT, Madras Mindworks, and Adray Digital for being the digital marketing partner. We bring this together to you every 3 weeks or so, and hopefully you will be able to come and attend our next session as well. Thank you so much. Stay safe. Namaste. Thank you.